All right, well then let's start the video as usual with last game's predictions. When you said Dallas wins 3-1 with goals from Eakin, Yanmark, and Jordy. Kind of didn't hit on any of them, even though the only hit that you did do was Dallas wins.
Yeah, well, can't win them all.
Yeah. But I, on the other hand, as per usual, I'm 2-1 in guessing when Dallas wins. Both scores, 4-2. So let's start with some Florida pregame interviews. The theme going into what seems to be for every user is for every opposing team that's going against Dallas, is the theme that they always harp on is Dallas's offense, which, you know, is a thing that they would want to harp on, to really watch out for. But the thing is that no one is really noticing Dallas's defense, which kind of, The thing about that is that Dallas is going to have teams that recognize their defensive skills to have true success right now in the NHL. Because when you go back and you look at championship teams, yes, they had offense, but they also had really, really good defense. Ooh, Klingberg with the snipe. That's the thing is, but Dallas, in after this game, is now leading the NHL and scoring at 3.8 goals a game, which is great. But at the end of this game, they are 19th in goals per game against, with 2.6 goals. Which, I mean, yeah, I guess you have to kind of take it as per usual with the Stars, because, you know, they still have a young D core. They're still going to have those mistakes. The only true veterans that we have are Oduya and Goligoski. I mean, Jordy is what Jordy is. Everyone knows that. So I just think that for Dallas to really truly start getting teams to take notice of their all-around plays, are going to have to shore up that defense. Maybe get it. If Dallas improves their goals per game against and goes up into maybe the 12th, 13th spot, I think Dallas will be in a much better position than riding around in 19th or maybe possibly in the 20s with goals per against. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, they're doing better with their defensive game, but there's still those little itty-bitty things that need to be tweaked that will make them overall better, like you said.
Well, see, that's one thing that I wanted to ask you about, since you grew up playing defense for the later parts of whenever you played competitive hockey. What do you see when Dallas plays defense? How do you think about their positioning? What things would you want to see them change right now? To improve on the 19th position of goals per.
I really feel it's what I've said the whole time since we've been doing these broadcasts, is just taking that a little extra half a second on the breakout to really hone down the pass, make it a worthwhile pass, and something that's going to keep the offense pushing into the opponent's defensive zone. Other than that, I think their positioning is pretty good. See with some of the younger guys, not so much Klingberg, but with Joakim Pekka just sometimes getting out of position.
Yeah, you could really tell.
But he gets right back in. He corrects his mistakes and saves the his positioning.
Yeah. Yeah, you could really tell on the second goal that Florida scored was just really bad defensive play from not so much as Joakim Paakka, but I'd say more on Jordy Benn, him getting caught, him coming all the way over. Like, once the puck goes under Joakim Paakka's stick, Jordy comes out of his way from the right side to try to shore up the left side, and he gets beat, and that leaves Perry to go in uncontested for the breakaway. I thought that was a real bad defensive breakdown. He could have played that a lot better. He should have just stayed within the middle to try and put better defense on the shot, but not letting a pass get across, I think, to let Kari really take that shot. But, you know, it is what it is. Going into the first period of the game, the Stars were clearly outplayed through the first period. But let's go to the coach's challenge. What did you feel? How did you feel about the coach's challenge?
I feel like the play should never have been called off. I think that should have been a good goal from the start.
I agree. I thought it was a clear-cut goal. The contact, like, I mean, there has to be a statute of limitations when it comes to contact with the goaltender, because he had clearly left. I mean, usually when goals get called off, it's like immediate contact or the goal gets scored like a second afterwards. Like, it was a good like 5 seconds after the player had left the crease and the contact had already been made, but then Kari just got flopping around. I thought, and I also thought that the call took too long. Like, what did they really have to look at? Like, why did it take like 5 minutes to decide, oh no, that's a good goal?
Yeah, I think Carr did do kind of a good job of selling it, though.
Well, yeah, I mean,
I guess the ref was looking at the fact that Carr really never got back into position, so maybe that contact did something to him. Maybe that's what was going through his mind.
I guess that could be it, but I still think that call shouldn't have been called off, and quite frankly, I think the call really like slowed down the game. I didn't think it should have taken as long as it did.
Yeah, it took roughly around like 4 to 5 minutes just to look at a screen and make the play. I mean, granted, I'm not in that position to make that call, but I feel like it could have been made a little quicker.
Yeah, I agree. I think an observation that I had from this game is that Dallas cannot make a theme of really, really, come on now, of, you know, getting down early and then trying to rally past it. Like, the Stars didn't have the jump that I would have liked to have seen them have against the Florida Panthers. I mean, everyone used in the past like 4 games that they've played, everyone in the post game and pregame always talk about Dallas's offense and how they'll jump on you fast. But Florida really applied the pressure that let them really, you know, control the game, set the tone of the game. And Dallas really just didn't have an answer for that for the first, I'd say, half of the game. I'd say the first period they were outplayed grossly, and then about like 8 minutes into the second period they were still outplayed grossly. It was one of those games that, looking at it, you wouldn't have been surprised if Dallas had really lost because of how they played in the first half of the game. I think that Dallas needs to come out and they need to set a tone really, really fast with their speed, their playmaking ability. It's something that, you know, Dallas has the upper hand when it comes to most teams and how they can apply their pressure, and not seeing what the team brings to them. I think that's something that they need to talk about and clean up really, really fast.
I feel like they need to start coming out more physical in the first period, along with their setting their tone with their playmaking. I feel like a lot of teams do their research on the start and see that they don't really have that physical game, so they bring it early. That way they get the momentum, and that way Dallas is always playing catch up.
Oh, I totally agree. And going back to the game stats and the numbers, do you want to guess what the hits were for each team?
I'm guessing Florida had more.
Oh yeah, it was grossly more. Well, not grossly. I mean, Dallas did wake up and start throwing around the body, but Florida had 36 hits to Dallas's 23. It's that just can't happen. It's something that every team now, I feel, is that's what their scouting report is going to be on the Stars. You know, Dallas can't afford to get pushed around by, I don't want to say lesser teams, because Florida is on the up and up, and they have a lot of good young talent, but clearly, Florida is not the team that the Stars should lose to. And for Florida to come in and bully the Stars the way they did in the first half of the game was, you know, not very great. I didn't like seeing that. But we can talk about the momentum of the game shifting to Dallas, and that would be the Jason Demers booming hip check from hell. Like, that hit right there clearly woke the Stars up. And they got the message that, oh, we actually need to start playing hockey against this team or we're going to lose. And then within like a minute of that hit, Sharp gets the interception of the pass. And it makes that beautiful feed to Sagan. It springs him on the breakaway, and Sagan gets his second goal of the season, which was a thing of beauty. It patented the first. You could tell like he wasn't too satisfied with the first goal, you know, because it was real greasy, of course. And it those are the goals that you have to get off the
Oh,
snide,
yeah.
but you could tell Tyler Seguin just liked this goal so much more because it was patented Tyler Seguin, which I really loved.
Yeah, it was a beautiful pass from Sharp to recognize to get
Yeah,
Sagan
and
springing.
Sharp's first point as a Dallas Star, getting him out of the goose egg column. Ooh. Which, you know, I think will go a long way for Sharp, especially in the first period when Sharp took that weird, awkward hit from, who was it? Was it Barkov that hit him?
Berenson or something.
Uh, was,
Soderby.
was that number 44 or something?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he took that hit and looked like he was really dazed, didn't got up awkward. And then had to go get checked out, but ultimately came back into the game. But that point is going to go a long way. Because, I mean, you could tell that Sharp really started to calm down. He started to play his game. You know, Sharp is known for being, you know, a good, like, Selke type offenseman. Like he has good defensive skill set, which he used in Chicago, and then I liked seeing that him bringing that here to Dallas. It's something Dallas needs.
Fucking shoot the puck.
And then going into, yeah, we're in the second period, so they get the power play, which I really like seeing. I think Dallas is now fourth in the league in power play. Which, you know, I don't think Dallas ever got as high as, like, 15th at all last season.
Definitely improved at home, especially in their power play.
Yeah. But Dallas now has the number one road power play, which is something you need to win road games. It's great seeing that... Oh, how's that not... it's great seeing that the Stars are actually starting to cash in on their power play chances. It's clearly night and day with how their power play is going.
Are my guys just not going to pick up the puck?
It was a great goal by Ben. It's an even better pass by Sagan. Sagan just gives a little dipsy do pass, and then Ben cuts and beats Luongo on the offside. It was a thing of beauty, and it looked effortless. When Ben and Sagan are on, everything just looks effortless. And talking more about Sagan, he was the clear player of this game. 4 points, 2 goals, 2 assists. I mean, when he's on, that dude is on. Like, I don't think there's another player outside of maybe Ovechkin, Stamkos, Crosby, even Ben. Like, when Tyler Sagan is feeling it, he's going to start producing points. And Sagan, in the post-game interviews, he was talking to Mike Hajka about how Tyler Sagan said that he's more of a notorious slow starter to the season. And when he wakes up, he'll wake up for good, and there's no looking back.
Well, hopefully he's woken up and he'll continue to produce and at this level.
Yep. Sagan is now top 5, I believe, in the NHL in assists. And Ben now co-leads the NHL in goals and is 2nd in the league with 8 points. He's 2nd in the league with 8 points in the NHL, which, you know. Oh my goodness. Post. Which is great to see. Yanmark's point streak comes to an end, which.
Oh my God.
I hated seeing his point streak coming to an end, but he had some good passes. I thought his line played really well. What'd you think of Faska's debut?
Oh, he almost had a goal on his first shift.
He almost had some of that magic going. What else did you see about his debut?
I really wish I could see my players stop icing the puck. He had a lot of hustle. He played his game that he knows how to play, which is a strong power forward type S game.
Yeah, he had some real big jump to his game. I thought he played really well. It didn't seem like he would ever give up on a play. He played some gritty hockey, but it also looked like he was kind of making a case to where, you know, he shouldn't be taken out of the lineup as well. He had some good blocks. I thought his grit turned out really well, even though, you know, he didn't get a point in his first game. Not every NHLer gets their first point or goal in their first game. So, you know, hopefully that doesn't discourage him. And he just keeps playing the way he is. And what'd you think of that little video they had on him in the intermission?
I had seen it on TSN, whenever on YouTube, on like their TSN channel.
Oh, see, that was the first time seeing it, and I thought it was a great story. You know,
Oh, yeah.
he has to leave home at 11 years old. I mean, that's tough on any kind of kid, no matter what sport or what kind of, you know, ethnicity or country you live in. I mean, I think that's tough on any kid. And for him to really, you know, embrace it, and him now being an NHL player, you know, those are the stories that, you know, are motivation that, you know, anybody could really do it if you try hard enough.
Oh, yeah. I'm still trying. My adult league, beer league games, they get pretty intense.
Now, what'd you think of Klingberg's game?
Definitely an improvement from his last game.
Yeah, I thought it was maybe not a complete 180, maybe like 150 degrees. I mean, he still had some bonehead plays. I think he was holding his stick a little tight. Like, you could tell on Sagan's second goal, like, if he hadn't gotten that puck off, that would have been another breakaway for Florida. Like, he almost had one of those plays that was either going to be really great or really bad at the blue line when he was falling down. But yeah, I think he had a much better game. What did you think of Nichushkin's play?
That kid's starting to piss me off.
Now, here's an observation that I had during the game. It looks like he would much rather play roller hockey. Oh, my God. It looks like he would much rather play roller hockey than ice hockey, because he does those real big, long circles. He doesn't stop and then start again. You know,
whenever he first was out there, he had jump. And towards the end of the game, I don't know where it went, because it wasn't there anymore.
Yeah, I completely agree. Like, from the start, it looked like he was out there to play physical. He wanted to throw his body around a bit. And then towards the end of the game, you could tell that people were starting to say, you know, what is going on with Nichushkin? Because he kind of disappeared in the game. You know, his effort seemed to... It seems like if he's not cashing in right away, or he feels like he's not playing the game that he should, it seems like his effort and his drive seems to drop a bit, which is pretty concerning to me.
I honestly believe that he should be in the AHL right now, playing in Cedar Park. He hasn't shown me anything worthy of being on the Dallas Stars lineup right now. People coming up from the AHL that are doing better jobs than him, and he's supposed to be like the best drafted Russian player since like Fedorov or some stuff. I don't know if that's true or not, but
no, he definitely had high praise going into him about it. And then, I mean, his first season with the Stars, like, I feel was much better than what we're getting now. I mean, yes, he was hurt in his second season and didn't get to play, but he had more drive and tenacity in him, in his style of play, than he's showing now, which is really concerning.
Oh, yeah. It kind of seems like whenever, like, he doesn't want to be out there. Like, I don't want to say that's his attitude that he has, but that's what it looks like.
Yeah, no, he does seem to have that type of attitude. Another observation, what do you think of this comparison? How do you, it looks like watching Florida play, they kind of remind me of the Boston Bruins. You know, they have real
like,
big...
Like how?
Not like their championship year, but Florida has real big bodies. They like to throw it around. And I think their style of play is they would much rather intimidate their opposing team than really just... Because I don't think they're going to be able to outplay a lot of teams in the NHL. So what they're going to do is they're going to use their body to really get the upper hand advantage in the game, and which they established that halfway through the game. Don't you agree?
Yeah.
So
they've definitely had a turnaround from last year.
So I just think that the Florida Panthers are maybe built like, not like the 2010 Bruins, but possibly like the 2011, 2012 Bruins, is that they have big bodies on defense, and they have big forwards too. So they come in and they just want to throw their body around.
Yeah, it kind of feels like they have their one scoring line, and then they have like three lines of checking.
Yeah. I mean, and it doesn't hurt having Sean Thornton on your fourth line to really intimidate some people, because you know Sean Thornton's not going to be any sort of offensive weapon, but he'll go out there and he'll police the game the way his team needs. And what'd you think of Kari in the game?
Except for that first goal, he was flopping around everywhere. I mean, he did all right. I would be kind of surprised if they stuck with him for Philly.
I truly think that that Dallas will probably bring in Niemi for Philadelphia. It just feels like that's where they would more lean towards that, or you know, bring Niemi in for Pittsburgh because he played so well against Pittsburgh. But I think you should give the look to Pittsburgh with a different team. All right, with a different goalie. I think it would be Dallas's advantage to put in Kari. That way, you know, they don't really know what to expect from Kari. So I do think that, you know, Niemi will probably get in as the starter for Philadelphia. Any observations that you had for the game that we didn't touch on?
Nah, I think we pretty much covered everything.
Okay, here's an observation that I had. Something that I've been talking about possibly in every discussion is just how impressed I am with Hemsky. Because he was even out there throwing his body around, which I truly, truly liked seeing. You know, Jason Spezza, it just seems like his level of play has really increased over the offseason. You know, it's his second year with the Stars, so he's a lot more comfortable, it seems. It just feels like last year's acquisitions that we had such high hopes on are really now just starting to flourish. I mean, Jason Spezza had a better second half, and certainly Hemsky had a better half for the Stars last season. But I continue to just be really impressed with how well those two are playing.
Oh, yeah.
Any thoughts on? Let's talk about Oduya. What are your thoughts on him with the five game, with the five game sample that we have on him now?
I think he just needs to relax and play his game, which he's doing. I kind of feel like he's trying too hard to make a contribution on the team right away. So it's costing him to get out of position a little bit, but overall, he's doing a good job.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's better to not be mentioned and just be known for just playing your game than it is for us to just be saying to noticing Oduya and noticing him for the wrong reasons. I think it's just best to stay unnoticed, go about your business, play your game, than it is to get noticed and it being for the wrong reasons. I'm liking him so far. I just think there's another level that we could get out of him as well. And hopefully it comes soon. I don't think we're expecting him to be, an offensive powerhouse for a defenseman, kind of like what I wouldn't say Trevor Daley was a powerhouse on offense, but he definitely brought a little more offense. But that's something that I think Dallas doesn't need. I think Dallas really needs to harp on our defensemen playing defense, which is why I think Oduya is with the team. We needed more defensive-minded defensemen, and I think that's what we're getting. And I like it. I like.
Yeah, we have our offensive defensemen in Goligoski and Klingberg.
Yeah,
Sometimes Demers. But we need to focus more on defense first than offense, because we have four lines of offense that can get it done.
yeah, very true. Now, with the game coming to close, what are your predictions for the Philadelphia game?
For some reason, I feel like the Philly game is going to be close. I'm going to say 3-2.
And who's on top?
Dallas.
Dallas. All right. Did you want to go with who scores?
No, I think I'll leave this one alone.
You're already discouraged, huh?
When I'm making passes like that, yeah.
You know what? I kind of like that prediction. The Philadelphia game does seem like it's out there to be. Well, actually, you know what? The Florida game felt like more of what a trap would be. It's the Florida game's like in the middle of Tampa and Philadelphia. That feels like it would have been more of a trap than anything, but now it feels like the Philadelphia game is built to be kind of a trap. I'm gonna have to say if Dallas wins, oh man, that 3-2 does sound appealing. But you know what? I'm gonna agree. Dallas wins 3-2. If Philadelphia wins, I'm going to say it'll be, four to three if Philadelphia wins.
Okay.
And with the Florida game in the books, what grade are we giving out for the Dallas Florida game? How'd you feel Dallas played, and what's your rating for him?
Well, I feel like they're probably a B minus.
B minus, interesting. And why
Just
give
because
that rate?
they're. Because of the work.
Yeah, I think I wrote down, I gave the Stars a B rating. I think they got grossly outplayed in the first half, which if they hadn't picked that up, that game was leaning more towards a D. But since they picked it up, they showed some heart, they rallied. I gave a B because I think halfway through that second period,
Oh, why'd you pass it there?
they were getting outshot 12-6. And then Dallas, after that goal, they ended that period, I think, outshooting the Panthers 15-4, which showed a lot of tenacity, a lot of a lot of grit to really start the rally.
Yeah.
So with them showing that heart that they did, I had to bump it up. And since they got good goaltending, the later part of the game, I gave a B rating. Okay. Let's see what we got here. Oh, I hit the post. That's crap. I'm not fancy with my shots. I like to just come in and put it on. God, you know what? This is one player I truly respect, Jaromir Jagr. Like he was always just one of those players that he was great and all, but he always played in the Eastern Conference. He didn't play for a team that I liked. So you couldn't really come in and respect Jágr the way you really truly could. But
Yeah.
since him coming back from the KHL and him having that brief period with the Stars, I truly looked at him, and that dude is truly one of the best hockey players I've ever seen.
I try to go for the old Jokinen.
Jokinen used to do that one-handed deke.
Well, he did
That Forsberg.
swooping low. He did the
Yeah.
swooping low left first.
Ah,
Yeah, the Nichushkin.
classic Nichushkin. Just come in all lackadaisical. Ooh.
Come on.
Who do I got up? Hemsky. Ah,
What were you trying to do there?
I tried to put some air on it, but he didn't get as much air as he did. Dang it. Ooh, hoo, hoo,
Oh!
hoo. Kari said, not in my house. We got Sharpie here. Ah!
Trying to do there?
I tried to be
The
fancy.
Patrick Kane?
Yeah. Yeah, just coming in, Deacon. Get out of here.
I'll take it.
Those are the goals that would beat me. Yeah,
What are you talking about? That was all skill.
I guess so. So that right there will end the discussion for the Dallas Stars versus the Florida Panthers. Tune in next time for.
I like how the Florida Panthers, the mascot was Stanley Cup, and it's 00 because they haven't won one.
Is that what it was?
I thought that was funny.
I didn't notice that.
I don't think it was because they haven't won one. I think it was just double zero for the number.
Well, because of the mascot. But no, that's
Yeah.
Wow, that's a good catch right there. So yeah. Tune in next time for the discussion.
Bye. Man, coming from behind on the penalty kill.
I know, you getting that fucking bullshit.